very proud to call him an ancestor.
Now I have chosen in the dark the desolate way to walk alone, yet strive to keep alive one spark of your known grace and grace unknown. And when I leave you, lest my love should seal your spirit's arc with clay, spread your bright wings, O shining dove, but my way is the darkest way. The Easter Rising of 1916 in Ireland was a rebellion against British rule and a pivotal moment in the country's struggle for independence. There were 16 leaders executed for their part in the rising, 13 of them in the Stonebreaker's Yard at Kilmainham Jail in Dublin. In truth, there had not been widespread support for this rebellion at first. But the executions and the manner in which they were carried out turned the rebels into national heroes overnight, and they are still revered to this day. It galvanized the population to demand independence, and it marked a turning point in Irish history. So what is Geraldine's family connection? If you follow her maternal line, Bridget, Margaret, Bridget and Margaret, we reach the sister of Patrick J. Plunkett, who is Joseph's grandfather. So Ger's grandmother, Margaret, was Joseph's second cousin, and Ger's great-great-grandmother was the sister of Joseph's grandfather. You would expect that this connection with someone so famous would have always been known, but was it?
I would say I only knew in the last 10, 15 years, because my sisters and a cousin of mine started to do a search on our family history. And yes, I was told I was related to him, how I didn't know at all, but it was never mentioned at home in my family. I did know I was related to Blessed Oliver Plunkett, as he was when I was growing up,
yeah.
Now St. Oliver Plunkett, but politics was never spoken in our house.
Politics could be a very contentious issue for many Irish families. Ideological divides tend to be left versus right, and there were elements of this in Ireland with the start of the trade union movement and the 1913 lockout. But the real divide in Ireland during most of the 1900s was mainly treaty-based. The Anglo-Irish Treaty, signed on the 6th of December 1921, established the Free State as a self-governing dominion, a pragmatic and important step according to its protagonists. But Ireland had to remain within the British Commonwealth, controversially requiring an oath of allegiance to the Crown. It also excluded six counties of Ulster, which are still under UK jurisdiction today. For the anti-treaty side, all of these factors were too much to compromise. Civil war broke out in 1922, and former comrades with a common foe now were torn apart from each other. A few years after his death in 1916, in spite of close former friendships with the signatories of the treaty like Michael Collins, Joseph's family was very anti-treaty, and the anti-treaty faction comprised Sinn Féin and subsequently influenced the development of the large Fianna Fáil party. The pro-treaty faction eventually evolved into the Fine Gael party in 1933. So why were politics never discussed in Ger's family?
Because my father was a staunch Fianna Fáiler,
yeah.
And my mother staunch Fine Gaeler. My mum, her brother was a TD and an MEP, so she was staunch Fine Gael. And I would say the only argument that ever occurred in our house was over politics during
really?
An election. Yeah, so never knew when I was growing up that he was related to me.
Less known but interesting facts about Jer's ancestor Joseph Plunkett is that he spoke around 6 languages, including Arabic. He had a major interest in wireless technology, and from a very young age, he had designed his own switchboard, getting his first signal out in 1907. He put this technology to use during the Rising. He ordered a trained detachment of men to enter the buildings at Rees Chambers. The aim? To get the wireless transmitter working again at the Irish School of Wireless. The plan was to get an uncensored message directly out to the world. This was intricate work, not least requiring the putting up of aerials under sniper fire. The Morse code message about the Rising reached New York. Rees's Chambers with these broadcasts are widely considered as the first pirate radio station in the world. It's reasonable to assume that not many people know that he was a champion roller skater. And while spending time in Algiers for health reasons, he was actually offered but declined the job of managing a local skating rink. His courage was legendary. Fellow rebel James Connolly at the GPO reassured his son Roddy of Plunkett's abilities in spite of his extremely frail appearance. He declared, "That's Joe Plunkett, and he has more courage in his little finger than all the other leaders combined." On the evening of the 3rd of May 1916, Joe's fiancée, Grace Gifford, waited 5.5 hours in Kilmainham Jail and was finally admitted into its chapel at 11:30 that night.
As we gather in the chapel here in old Kilmainham Jail, I think about these past few weeks, or will they say we failed? From our school days they have told us we must yearn for liberty. Yet all I want in this dark place is to have you here with me. Oh, Grace just told me, in your arms and let this moment linger. They'll take me out at dawn and I will die. With all my love, I place this wedding ring upon your finger. There won't be time to share our love, for we must say goodbye.
Grace later said that he was so unselfish, never thought of himself, and that he was quite calm, not frightened, not at all. It seems that Joseph's family had mixed views about Grace for a variety of reasons. His mother worked to deny Grace any Plunkett-related inheritance, but eventually it was settled out of court and Grace was awarded £700. There was clearly little love lost between mother and daughter-in-law based on this cartoon, which was drawn by Grace. She was on the anti-treaty side, and for that reason, she was imprisoned in Kilmainham for 3 months in 1923. She never remarried and died alone in December 1955. She was given a military funeral and buried near the Republican plot in Glasnevin. So what does Jer think of Joseph as a person?
Well, having read about him now, I feel he was an amazing man, from being part of the 1916 Rising, organising it, to being a poet. And being so ill with TB, he performed all of these things and died when he was only 28.
So what do you think his legacy is?
Well, being part of the 1916 Rising, he always go down in history. One of the signatories of the Proclamation, and an inspiration to everybody, from his poetry to the song, Grace, he will always be remembered.
There won't be time to share our love, for we must say goodbye.